This week, Siskel and Ebert review River Phoenix playing a cruel joke in Dogfight. Jennifer Beals picks up a dangerous drifter in Blood and Concrete. And Laura Dern is a southern sexpot in Rambling Rose.
Phoenix and his Marine buddies play a cruel trick on women before shipping out to Vietnam in Dogfight. It's one of four new movies we'll be reviewing this week on Siskel and Ebert. I'm Gene Siskel of the Chicago Tribune.
And I'm Roger Ebert of the Chicago Sun-Times. Our first movie is named Dogfight, and it takes place during one long night in San Francisco in November of 1963. A group of young Marines are having their last shore leave before shipping out to the Far East, and they pool their money to hold a party called a Dogfight, because each one of them is supposed to ask an ugly girl to the party, and the Marine with the ugliest date gets the cash prize. This almost unbearably cruel contest leads one of the young Marines, played by River Phoenix, to ask out a sweet and shy young waitress, played by Lily Taylor.
I'm a Marine. The Marines are jerks. Everybody knows that. Now, if you don't want to go with me, just say so.
It's just my mom would be alone.
Well, I don't want to get anyone in trouble with her old ladies. So.
At first she says no, but then she reconsiders.
Oh, this is great.
I'm gonna go get changed now.
Okay.
What kind of party is this?
A party party.
A dress-up party?
Yes, a dress-up party.
When she discovers the secret purpose of the party, she's angry with him, not so much because of what happened to her, as because of the very idea of a dogfight.
Who gave you the right to treat people like this? Vicious. All of you are just vicious.
I'm sorry.
How can you be sorry? You have no feelings. You're just a worthless excuse for a human being.
Hey, that's my ship.
Shut up, you creep.
Dogfight is a movie about young men and women, but it's also about the mood of America on the eve of the Kennedy assassination and the beginning of the Vietnam War. In an epilogue, we see those same two characters 3 years later after there have been enormous changes in both of them and also in their country. In a way, the process that begins between them on that long night of the dogfight is the same process the whole country is about to go through. I really like this movie, which was directed by Nancy Savoca, the same woman who made True Love 2 years ago, and which is warm and sensitive and filled with idealism. And I greatly admire the performances by Lily Taylor and River Phoenix. Good acting.
Well, I think the acting is good. My problem was that I thought that the picture had a sort of logical conclusion when we see him in a shot going off to the off a bridge there. And I thought that we had set up the male-female possibilities of how people can relate to each other pretty well. Then we get things laid out a little bit with a heavy hand involving Vietnam and the Kennedy assassination, and I thought that was sort of routine stuff. And
but
I
have that's one only the last 5 minutes of the movie.
Well,
that
my
you're
problem.
Objecting to.
Okay, my problem. I'll give you another a minor thing, but it goes to the heart of this picture. I didn't think that I thought that she was picked was a manipulation because she isn't wildly ugly like some of the other people.
It was the
picked.
Best he could do.
There's another. Here's another one. Remember when he says to her, "I didn't really. I tried to let you get out of it."
Yeah.
Remember that. There's a mistake in the movie because remember he puts, he tries to ugly her up, if you will, by putting lipstick all
yeah,
over her at
earlier,
the same time. At the
he
same
said, we
time.
Don't really have to go in here, he says.
Then he puts yeah. it all over her. So it, the movie's
Gene,
trying
these
to have
are
to,
not these are not objections that have anything to do with whether anybody would like this movie or not.
These are
nitpicking.
No, I don't think they're nitpicking.
And as far as your first objection,
yeah.
which I presume was your most important
yes,
one,
it was.
Because the other two are completely insignificant. He does come back after 3 years in Vietnam, and something does happen between them that I think is a perfect moment and a perfect epiphany for the movie. They have got to see each other one more time, or this movie isn't over.
Well,
you can't just go off into the sunset
Wayne. No, I think that the possibilities of how men and women will relate to each other, and basically we're talking about kindness or cruelty, which sets up the whole picture. I think that is sad. very clearly in, as I said, when he walks
off
to the
bridge. Well, you would rather have an incomplete ending than to have it come full circle.
I can fill it in. I'm smart enough.
Well, if you're that smart, how come you didn't like the movie?
Well, I didn't care for a number of the things that were in the picture. Our next movie is an enjoyable offbeat romantic comedy called Late for Dinner, about a couple of goofy brothers-in-law who are back in 1962, and they're frozen by a quirky doctor and reawaken in 1991. They're perfectly preserved, except their family and friends don't know where they've been.
No.
Here's where they first return to see one of the men's daughters,
please,
now grown from a three-year-old to a mature married woman.
I used to give you rides on my back when you were just a little girl. Well, you're too big for that now.
That's Brian Wimmer from TV's China Beach as Willie, her father, and Peter Berg plays her blissfully offbeat Uncle Frank. Later, her father summons up the courage to ask her what has happened after all these years to his wife, her mother.
She didn't love me anymore.
You don't know how long she waited.
Late in the film, there is an emotional reunion between the estranged husband and wife. She's well played by Marcia Gay Harden.
Remember that funny way that you snore when your nose gets all plugged up?
No, I'm married. I mean, my boss married. I've been married 4 or 5 years.
Well, now you're not. Joy, I've run through every life you could ever live coming back here. You know the truth, and I know the truth. We're supposed to be together.
Late for Dinner is really two good movies. The first half of the film is the introduction of these characters, and it's sort of a rascally modern cowboy movie. Then it turns into a very sweet, time-traveling romance with some of the same appeal as the movie Ghost. And this story has a much quirkier personality, thanks to writer Mark Andrus and director W.D. Richter, who also directed the cult hit The Adventures of Buckaroo Banzai, a good film. I like Late for Dinner very much.
I agree with you that it's basically two movies, and I only like the second movie.
I like the second one better.
I feel that the gimmickry involved in the cryogenic freezing of these two people is really manipulation that comes from outside in order to make the plot happen, and
yeah,
you
well,
can't
of course
really take it seriously. And then at the end, though, when he does come back, you see, then the conversation that they have and the emotional interchange that takes place is very nice.
It is.
And very
sweet. So are you recommending the picture?
That's a close call, but no, I'm not recommending it.
But the beginning of the film is so wild. I mean, that you wouldn't expect, you don't expect them to be frozen.
Yeah.
And then the way they're reawakened, I mean, is well done technically.
I think the whole first half of the movie, or even more than the first half of the movie, is just a real, 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 real elaborate setup in order to get a scene. The whole movie is a build up to one scene, which is what would happen if you met someone that hadn't changed in 29 years and you were still in love with that person.
And you would change.
Yeah, and you would change. That's what the whole movie is about, and that scene does work, but you don't need all the setup mechanism. I would like to have the setup take place over the titles, then have the scene that we like, be the first scene of the movie proper, and then let's have an hour and a half about how they would get along with 29 years in difference in the age of two people who originally were the same age.
The only thing that I will agree with you on is I wanted the picture to go on longer with them because I liked the way they related at the end of the film.
Okay, when we come back, Rambling Rose with Laura Dern is the strange and troubled young girl who comes to live with an offbeat Southern family.
You going out in public in those clothes?
Mm-hmm.
It's a capital letter S. You will adorn our house, you'll give a glow and a shine to these old walls.
The year is 1935, and that's Robert Duvall as the patriarch of a big, eccentric Southern family. And that is the moment that's going to change all of their lives as a troubled teenage girl named Rose comes to live with that family. She's played by Laura Dern in Rambling Rose as a woman who has already had some hard times in life, but who fits in well in this big, friendly family, all except for her tendency to be a little too interested in sex.
Is that my outfit? I made most of it myself.
Well, it's very cheerful.
Yeah, I have a knack for designing clothes.
Diane Ladd, Dern's real-life mother, plays the mother there, and all of these people are surprisingly tolerant of Rose, who is diagnosed as a near-nymphomaniac. And her private life provides lively dinner table conversation.
Now, Rose, when I have to get up in the middle of the night and defend my home against a couple of damn scoundrels fighting in the bushes.
Scoundrels? They weren't scoundrels. They were just boys. Boyfriends of Rose's, that's all they were. And why shouldn't she have boyfriends? Don't you think she's human, the same way as you are yourself?
The family's son, played by Lucas Haas, is 13 years old and very, very interested in Rose, who seems in a perfect position, he thinks, to tutor him on the facts of life.
Buddy, I'm gonna tell you a secret. Girls don't want sex. Girls want love.
Rambling Rose was directed by Martha Coolidge and written by Calder Willingham, and Willingham's screenplay took on a near legendary status in Hollywood in the years it took to get this offbeat project made. And no wonder, this movie is a masterpiece of comic tone, and it takes difficult and challenging material and turns it into a gentle, nostalgic human comedy. The performances are crucial to that process by Robert Duvall, Diane Ladd, young Lucas Haas, and especially by Laura Dern, who has to play a character both deeply troubled and deeply lovable. I like this movie.
I like the film, too, and it is the acting. In the wrong hands, this picture would be a disaster and embarrassing, and instead, it's challenging and exciting to see a film that dares to, an American film that dares to deal with sexuality. Mm-hmm. I mean, we don't get them very often anymore, and that's too bad. This does it very, very well. It's also quite touching. There's a line late, Calder Willingham line late in the picture, where they're talking about a character, and someone says, some people die and some people don't. Mm-hmm. And I thought how beautiful a line that was, mm-hmm. that you can live a life in a fashion so that you will never die, and then there are other people, sadly too many people, mm-hmm. whose lives have no meaning, and they are truly dead. And when that line scores, it's like a printout for how much this picture means to you. It's beautiful.
It's a very special film because it deals with material that we've seen before in on the stage, in television, the movies, and deals with it in an original way, because this woman does have a very kind of out-of-control sexuality, which everyone in the family understands and deals with in their own way because they also care for her and care about her. And there's even room within that understanding for the teenage kid to really be excited by this girl who's moved in and who want to get some quick lessons in the birds and the bees. And so there's that humor going on along with a very deep and darker current as well.
The other thing is that, listen, the audience that goes to see movies is more interested in sexual issues than the movies ever let them be involved in.
That's right.
This picture lets you participate fully. It's very, very well done. Coming up next, Blood and Concrete, the story of a small-time crook and a suicidal rock singer, Billy Zane and Jennifer Beals from Flashdance co-star.
I'm in a little bit of trouble, and it would be a lot easier if we can just blow.
Ben.
That's Jennifer Beals from Flashdance playing a rock singer who wants to end her life as the movie Blood and Concrete begins, and she is stopped from killing herself by Billy Zane. Remember him, the killer in Dead Calm, and together they star in one of the year's most violent, pointless movies. Zane plays a small-time thief who has been wounded by a drug dealer, and he recovers in Beale's home.
So, what do you do for work?
I'm in a career transition at the moment.
Beale's character is addicted to a love drug, which he is regularly popping and which is responsible for her goofy behavior. The two are constantly on the run in the picture, although there is time out for Jennifer Beals to sing. She's okay singing. Unfortunately, she has to get back to the dialogue in this picture. Blood and Concrete tries to borrow elements from terrific and stylish pictures like Sid and Nancy or David Lynch's Wild at Heart, but this is just a miserable mess with wildly overwrought characters just stunting for the cameras. I hate to say it, but I was rooting for these characters to OD and for the movies to end.
This is a movie that gave me one of the most unpleasant times I've ever had in a movie theater.
Mm-hmm.
It is stupid, it is ugly, it is reprehensible. There is nothing in it of redeeming merit. It's a complete waste of time for the people who made it, and it was certainly a waste of time for me.
There's a I don't know, you wonder what's the cachet of putting on violent, ugly characters.
And stupid, too.
Yeah.
And then to not even handle it in a realistic way, but to try to even weasel out of the violence that's there by pretending that in some way it's supposed to be funny as well.
Yeah. Kenneth Branagh's new thriller, Dead Again, recently went to number one at the American box office. And when we come back, Roger will talk to the British actor and director about acting and directing.
His wife, Margaret, and that was their home. Handsome man, wasn't he? Not at all the sort who'd murdered his wife.
That's a scene from Kenneth Branagh's Dead Again, a movie that has so much fun dealing with the high style of movie melodrama that is going on my list of the year's best films. Branagh is the boy wonder of the British stage and screen, and his film of Henry V won Oscar nominations in America for Best Director and Actor 2 years ago. An achievement like that at his age inspires inevitable comparisons with another one-time boy wonder.
We few, we happy few, we band of brothers.
When Kenneth Branagh won Oscar nominations at the age of 28 for directing and starring in Henry V, the comparisons to a Hollywood legend began. Just like Orson Welles, Branagh's background was with a theater troupe of his own. Many of his colleagues wound up in Henry V just as Welles brought his Mercury players out to Hollywood for the making of his first film, Citizen Kane. And the two men wound up with the same two Academy Award nominations. It's not surprising to find that Branagh is quite a student of Welles.
I've read a great deal about Welles because it seems to me that he had this incredible opportunity and, of course, this incredible talent. I do think he's a dyed-in-the-wool genius as far as I'm concerned, but with an extraordinary capacity for self-destruct. The world is fascinated by what happened to Orson Welles. When did it start going kind of mad? In a sense, I look to it to try and learn lessons of where, not just me, because there are similarities in as much as, you know, one's an actor, director, but on a more general level about what happened.
Branagh also says Welles was always fighting the system, battling with studios and moguls, while he thinks times have changed and Hollywood has to be accepted for the business that it is.
He had a combative attitude to the money and maybe that was a time in which it was important to have that. Mm-hmm. This attitude that Welles had, this combative attitude, I think was one of the things that seemed to dissipate his energies. Because obviously if you resist in that way, as fiercely as that, although obviously the desire is to protect your work, I think it took him away from what he was doing and certainly it created a great deal of resentment on the part of the studios.
Your last two films have been your own productions. Is this going to be a trend?
Well, I've enjoyed it enormously. I would love in the short term just to act in a movie. Mm-hmm. It would be nice to, you know, walk away after 2 or 3 months instead of 18. But the feeling of finishing something to the pitch that you wanted at anyway, with all its imperfections on its head, is immensely satisfying. To have gone that kind of route, and particularly in post-production for Dead Again, which was an immensely difficult job to get in balance all the elements of thriller and romance and comedy, suspense, to combine a big score with a theme based on reincarnation, which meant that it was all a little larger than life. Mm. Just getting all that in balance was difficult, but at the end, to have done it at least in a way that satisfied me was very satisfying, and so I will undoubtedly want to do it again.
Dead Again is currently in release around the country. When we come back, our video pick of the week, a long-running documentary by a director who's been following the same people for 28 years. My video pick of the week this week is a little-known movie that is nevertheless on my list of the greatest films of all time for the way it explores the mysterious ways that movies can transcend the passage of time. The name of the film, at least for this go-around, is 28 Up, and it's a documentary by Michael Apted, a British director who first filmed his subjects when they were 7 years old and then again at ages 14, 21, and 28. And recently, he made in England 35 Up about these characters at the age of 35, but that's not out on video yet. What's fascinating in 28 Up is the way you sometimes feel you're glimpsing the whole lives of these people predicted in their faces when they're still children.
When I get married, I'd like to have two children.
I'm not very children-minded at the moment. I don't know if I ever will be.
What do you think about them?
Oh, I don't like babies.
This movie, which is brand new on video this week, is unlike any other film I've ever seen, and it inspires long conversations after you've viewed it.
It is a terrific film, and an American project similar has already been started to follow children through the years, and it is great to see that kind of story. It's a wonderful film and worth renting. Now let's take another look at the movies we reviewed this week. A split decision on Dogfight, the 60s sexual drama that Roger really liked. I had problems with its story, and particularly with its ending. Another split vote on Late for Dinner, the time-traveling romantic comedy. I really enjoyed the mix of fantasy and sweetness. Roger wanted more follow-through. Two big thumbs up for Ramblin' Rose, the beautifully acted Calder-Willingham story. Laura Dern gives a special performance in a difficult role. And two thumbs down, way, way down, for Blood and Concrete, a pointless piece of violence. So Ramblin' Rose is the picture we both really like, and it is very good.
I think it's a good picture. That's it for this week. Next week, we'll be back with Paradise, starring Melanie Griffith and Don Johnson as a couple overcoming a personal tragedy. And also The Fisher King, starring Robin Williams as a street person who befriends down-and-out Jeff Bridges. That's next week, and until then, the balcony is closed.
A-Watch by Armatron, featuring water-resistant straps and metal cases in over 20 fashion designs to match your entire wardrobe. Medals of distinction. That's A-Watch by Armatron, America's watch. Brute. It captures everything that makes a man in one great scent. Brute, the essence of man. Delicious five-bar snack bars. A great-tasting snack that's a great way to get your fiber anytime you want. Five-bar snack bars. High in fiber, big on taste. Rice-A-Roni, the San Francisco treat. Now with 30 flavors. You can serve it every day for a month and never serve the same dish twice.
The pain was indescribable.